despite whatever conspiratorial theories, there's nothing to it.
I just received an email from a brother in Christ. It is an interview between two men, and it showed me why we need to study history, current affairs, and the Bible. Please watch. Independent thought is frowned upon, and those who think outside of the cultural paradigm are looked on with suspicion. In Newsweek magazine, dated the 23rd of May 2014, there is a very interesting article about conspiracy theories in America. It says, "Where does a conspiracy theory come from? Often it is generated by fringe groups whose information is picked up by more credible sources until it eventually reaches the mass media. Conspiracy theories are espoused by people at every level of society, seeking ways of calming the chaos of life, sometimes by simply reinforcing convictions. Experts say the number and significance of conspiracy theories are reaching levels often heard of in recent times, in part because of ubiquitous and faster communications offered by internet chat rooms, Twitter, and social media. George W. Bush murdered thousands by orchestrating 9/11. Barack Obama is a Kenyan national and holds the presidency illegally. Education standards developed by state governors are part of an anti-Christian communist plot that will turn children gay. Unemployment rates and the reported numbers for Obamacare signups are lies engineered by the White House. Water fluoridation doesn't prevent cavities in children and has been adopted for a range of nefarious purposes, and on they go. Research conducted by Professors Oliver and Wood, published in March by the Journal of the Medical Association, shows that 49% of respondents believed in at least one medical conspiracy theory, while 18% believed in three or more. The theories best known to the respondents involved cancer treatments, vaccines, and cell phones. These were also the ones that saw the greatest numbers of people subscribing to them. 37% believed that Food and Drug Administration was conspiring with pharmaceutical companies to suppress natural cures for cancer, while 20% thought that corporations were preventing the government from releasing data showing that cell phones cause cancer, or that doctors secretly believe vaccines are dangerous but still want to use them on children. According to a poll last year by Public Policy Polling, a national firm, 28% of Americans believe a secret power elite is conspiring to rule the world through a global authoritarian government. 15% believe the government adds mind control technology to television broadcasts. And 14% think the Central Intelligence Agency was instrumental in introducing crack cocaine to America's inner cities during the 1980s. The last one is not a conspiracy. In an article in the Times of London dated to January 30, 1988, it confirmed that the CIA worked with Colombian drug cartels to flood America with drugs, especially within the black communities in the 1970s and the 1980s. In a well-researched and documented book, filing through declassified CIA documents, the author Harriet A. Washington uncovered that the CIA, under operation titled MK Ultra and MK Naomi, targeted black Floridans with swarms of disease-carrying mosquitoes that had yellow fever and dengue fever in domestic bioterrorism research from the 1950s to the 1970s. That's not conspiracy, but facts. Britain's Minister of Defence had a scientist who worked for them. He was Dr. David Kelly, Britain's leading weapons inspector, who died mysteriously in 2003. Many said he was murdered and were labelled as conspiracy theorists. But a re-investigation into his death has shown that it wasn't suicide as originally presented, but sinister forces were at work. Georgetown University is the most influential academic institution in the United States. It was founded by John Carroll, a Jesuit and the first Roman Catholic bishop and archbishop in the United States. Friar Edmund Walsh, an Irish-American Jesuit, founded the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University, the first diplomatic school in the United States. A lecture was given there in 2006, and you get to see how dissent will be dealt with in the not-too-distant future.
Subject of counterinsurgency, and particularly counterinsurgency in Iraq, we are pleased at Georgetown School of Foreign Service and our Center for Peace and Security Studies to be joining with the Navy Center for Asymmetric Warfare to sponsor this morning's sessions. My name is Bob Gallucci. I'm the Dean of the School of Foreign Service. And we have as a first panel on the topic of counterinsurgency three panelists. Their bios are in front of you, but I would be shocked and depressed if you didn't know who they were without me introducing them. Speaking second, Colonel T.X. Hames. His bio is there as well, 30 years in the Marine Corps, as it says, serving at all levels in the operating forces.
External actors have to be eliminated. These guys who are coming in are the most dangerous of all because they're true believers. And true believers, whether they're Muslim, they're Christian, or they're Marine, are dangerous people because there is no other way other than their way. And you've got to eliminate them.
Colonel Thomas X. Hames, a retired U.S. Marine officer who specializes in counterinsurgency warfare, said that radicals that included Marines, Muslims, and Christians need to be eliminated. A shadow of things to come. In a document by the Homeland Security and the FBI published in 2009, titled Right-Wing Extremism, Current Economic and Political Climate Fueling Resurgence in Radicalization and Recruitment, on page 4, under the heading Economic Hardship and Extremism, it highlights who the government is carefully watching. It reads, anti-government conspiracy theories, and stressed in double speech mark quotes, end times prophecies could motivate extremist individuals. On Wikipedia, under the subject New World Order, Conspiracy Theory, when you scroll down and click on 2.1, End Times, it says on the last half of the first paragraph, in many contemporary Christian conspiracy theories, the false prophet will either be the last pope of the Catholic Church, groomed and installed by an Alta Vendita or Jesuit conspiracy. And this is where our study will pick up from.
Hi, I'm Randy Robinson. This is Life Today TV. I'm here with someone who's kind of been making some waves lately. Bishop Tony Palmer is with the Episcopal Church and the Anglican Church. He's actually based in England. But he's made a bit of a name for himself by speaking with an old friend of his who is now the Pope. So, Tony, thank you for sitting down with me.
Pleasure.
I am going to say this because I can already hear it. In fact, I've already heard it. Yeah. There's this whole kind of I won't call the names. There's a group that thinks that the Catholic Church is out to get us all, mm-hmm. and that any of this conversation that you're having is signs
right.
that the Catholic Church, which is the beast in Revelation, is yes. coming in to get us all. And
yes.
How do you cope with some of the, not just the crazies, but the legitimate people that are concerned about this unification means subordination to the Catholic Church?
This man, Randy Robinson, makes a mockery of those who believe that the papacy is the first beast of Revelation chapter 13, and he labels them as the crazies. Let us quote from credible secular sources on the papacy's plans for world domination. In London's National Archives are thousands of declassified government documents, and one of them is from the late British diplomat Francis Darcy Godolphin Osborne, the 12th Duke of Leeds and the British envoy and minister to the Vatican. And this is what he wrote in his correspondence to the British government. In any case, I long ago realized that it is almost impossible for a layman and a non-Catholic, and indeed for most Catholics and ecclesiastics outside the Vatican City, to form a valid judgment or express an authoritative opinion on papal policy. The Pope's decision may or must be influenced by so many imponderable or invisible elements. Moreover, not only is the atmosphere of the Vatican supranational and universal, but it is also fourth-dimensional and, so to speak, outside of time. For example, they can regard the Savoy dynasty as an interlude and the fascist era as an incident in the history of Rome and Italy. They reckon in centuries and plan for eternity, and this inevitably renders their policy inscrutable, confusing, and, on occasion, reprehensible to practical and time-conditioned minds. So those in diplomatic circles say that it is a system that operates so skillfully that both Catholics and non-Catholics do not understand how it works, for he said they reckon or plan out their strategies in terms of centuries. The late Karol Wojtyla, better known as Pope John Paul II, boosted the global profile of the papacy. States that were once hostile to the papacy, such as the Protestant nations as the UK and the United States and communist Russia, put their guard down and established official diplomatic ties with the papacy under Pope John Paul II. A trained actor and cunning geopolitician, the secular press knew why he was making constant trips all around the world, and London's Daily Telegraph wrote two articles in 2 months in 1991 of what was his true agenda. In Europe's smallest sovereign state, Karol Wojtyla is calmly preparing to assume the mantle which he solemnly believes is his divine right, that of the new Holy Roman Emperor, reigning from the Urals to the Atlantic. Using the same language as a British diplomat, the Daily Telegraph also says, "The Vatican notoriously thinks in centuries." And in Pope John Paul II, we have the most political pope of modern times. It is in the movement towards federalism of the common market, with the coming membership of Eastern European countries, as well as in the turmoil in the Soviet Union, that the Pope may see the greatest possibility for an increase in Catholic political power since the fall of Napoleon or since the Counter-Reformation. So the secular press is also aware of the papacy's plans. Let's quote one more secular source. Elisa Zinovyevna Rosenbaum, better known as Ayn Rand, was a Russian-born American novelist, philosopher, playwright and screenwriter. She was famous for her pagan philosophy called objectivism, which is, in a nutshell, trust in your own heart and you'll be saved. But in her book titled Capitalism, The Unknown Ideal, she says, "The Catholic Church has never given up the hope to re-establish the medieval union of church and state, with a global state and a global theocracy as its ultimate goal." So three secular sources have unequivocally confirmed the papacy's objectives and plans: the secular press, diplomatic circles, and a novelist. But why is it that the modern churches that are meant to be that city that is set on a hill are so blinded? Jesus tells us the reason why when he said, "For the children of this world are in this generation wiser than the children of light." The Lord says even the world is more wiser than the church. To be fair to the papacy, we will quote, as shown in some previous studies, her own words, for it will confirm everything. At the Second Vatican Council in the 1960s, thousands of bishops and priests from all over the world gathered in Vatican City and laid out her cunning ecumenical strategy for the entire planet. In one of her documents titled Gaudium et Spes, she calls for a one world government, and she cleverly words it as it being a force for peace to cover up her true agenda. It is clear that we should give all our energies to hastening the day when, by common consent of the nations, war may be altogether banned. This obviously calls for the setting up of some universal public authority recognized by everybody, commanding effective power to guarantee for everybody's security, regard for justice, and respect for rights. The papacy sees herself as this universal public authority. Listen to Roman Catholic canon law. "The Roman pontiff alone has the right to judge heads of state. The church has the right always and everywhere to proclaim moral principles, even in respect of the social order, and to make judgments about any human matter, insofar as this is required by fundamental human rights or the salvation of souls." Seeing herself as this universal public authority, she believes that she doesn't have to give an accountability to no one for his actions, even when she is confronted by the United Nations for covering up years of sexually molesting her own Roman Catholics, for it sees itself as infallible. There is neither appeal nor recourse against a judgment or a decree of the Roman pontiff. In a summary, anything the Pope says or publishes can never be challenged. The first see is judged by no one. The Roman pontiff to whom the words primus sedes apply cannot be judged on earth by any human power. The Pope is the supreme judge in the church, and only God may judge him. Not even the Pope himself may renounce the prerogative which proceeds from divine law. When it is said that the first see cannot be submitted to the judgment of any human power, it should be understood to refer both to the decisions handed down by the Pope, as well as to those which he appropriates to himself with formal and express approval or acceptance. This is why she doesn't want to answer for her deep, disgusting culture of paedophilia. She covers up the horrors of her laity. Though the late Pope John Paul II didn't see his dream fulfilled while alive, the 1990 book The Keys of This Blood by Malachi Martin, as shown in a previous study, outlines his plans for his successors. 4. In the final analysis, John Paul II, as the claimant vicar of Christ, does claim to be the ultimate court of judgment on the society of states as a society. At his most specific, however, he insists that men have no reliable hope of creating a viable geopolitical system or a new world order unless it is on the basis of Roman Catholic Christianity. Throughout the 21st century, the Vatican has produced article after article calling for a one world government where she will be the one steering the ship. She has repeatedly shown who she is and what are her objectives, but professed Christians ridicule what she says she wants to do when she is open about it. What does the Vatican think about Randy Robinson? In September the year 2000, Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, who was to become Pope for 5 years later, said that non-Catholic churches are not true churches in a letter titled Dominus Jesus. The ecclesial communities which have not preserved the valid episcopate and the genuine and integral substance of the Eucharist mystery are not churches in the proper sense. These separated churches and communities as such, we believe they suffer from defects. Furthermore, it cannot be overlooked that other rituals, insofar as they depend on superstitions or other errors, constitute an obstacle to salvation. What is even more startling is that when you open up this letter and look at the footnotes, you clearly see where Ratzinger got his inspiration from, a 14th century medieval text called Unum Sanctum. Wikipedia described the papal bull Unum Sanctum as the most extreme statements of papal supremacy ever made. The first edition of the Roman Catholic Encyclopedia has preserved its text, and we can get a picture of her plans for the entire earth. Unum Sanctum, which is a Latin for the one holy church, the bull on papal supremacy, issued the 18th of November 1302 by Boniface VIII during the dispute with Philip the Fair, King of France. The bull is universal in character. It reads, "It is here stated that for salvation it is necessary that every human creature be subject to the authority of the Roman Pontiff." Bishop Tony Palmer begins to show his true colors and defends auricular confession, confessing your sins to a priest.
But do they believe that the Pope and priests have the power for remittance of sins?
Well, you're talking about absolution. And what absolution really is, it's the fact that we have, in the name of Christ, not in our name or in a Roman Catholic priest's name, in the name of Christ, we can confess or pronounce over you that you are forgiven because you have repented and asked forgiveness of your sins. So we are simply saying, when we reach out a hand and touch someone, says, "Be healed in Jesus' name." It's exactly the same act. We are telling you what God is saying over you.
Does that mean that one has to, do the Catholics still believe that you have to go to a priest to get God's forgiveness of your sins? Even if God's doing the forgiveness, do you have to go to the priest?
That is the Catholic Church's teaching, because it is a priest that is able to hear your sins and to pray for you and for you to receive your forgiveness.
Is that the Anglican teaching? That's certainly not the Protestant teaching.
No, it's not.
Let us take a proper and careful look at the role of the priest. In a book titled Dignities and Duties of the Priests of Selva, written by an Italian Catholic bishop, Alfonso Maria de Liguori, we get a clear picture of the papacy's true view of the priesthood, and these are her own words. "The priest holds the place of the Savior himself, when, by saying ego te absolvo, he absolves from sin. This great power, which Jesus Christ has received from his eternal Father, he has committed to his priests. Jesus," says Tertullian, "invests the priests with his own powers. According to Saint Ambrose, a priest in absolving a sinner performs the very office of the Holy Ghost in the sanctification of souls. Innocent III has written, "Indeed, it is not too much to say that in view of the sublimity of their offices, the priests are so many gods." Saint Francis of Assisi used to say, "If I saw an angel and a priest, I would bend my knee first to the priest and then to the angel." At Mass, they believe that the wafer is literally Jesus Christ. We find that in obedience to the words of his priests, "Hoc est corpus mum," God himself descends on the altar, that he comes wherever they call him, and as often as they call him, and places himself in their hands, even though they should be his enemies. And after having come, he remains entirely at their disposal. They move him as they please from one place to another. They may, if they wish, shut him up in the tabernacle, or expose him on the altar, or carry him outside the church. They may, if they choose, eat his flesh and give him for the food of others. "Oh, how very great is their power," says Saint Lawrence Justinian, speaking of priests. "Oh, wonderful dignity of the priests," cries out Saint Augustine. "In their hands, as in the womb of the Blessed Virgin, the Son of God becomes incarnate. Hence, priests are called the parents of Jesus Christ." Such is the title that Saint Bernard gives them. Thus the priest may, in a certain manner, be called the creator of his creator. This is blasphemy. The dignity of the priest is so great that he even blesses Christ on the altar as a victim to be offered to the Eternal Father. "In the sacrifice of the Mass," writes Father Manti, "Jesus is the principal offerer and victim. As minister, he blesses the priest, but as victim, the priest blesses him." This can be verified in a more recent publication. In a book titled The Faith of Millions by a highly respected Roman Catholic dignitary, it reads, "The power of the priest is equal to that of Jesus Christ. When the priest pronounces the tremendous words of consecration, he reaches up into the heavens, brings Christ down from his throne, and places him upon our altar to be offered up again as the victim for the sins of man. The priest speaks, and lo, Christ, the eternal and omnipotent God, bows his head in humble obedience to the priest's command." Are you now becoming more aware why the scripture says twicefold in Revelation that upon his heads the name of blasphemy in Revelation chapter 13 and verse 1, and full of names of blasphemy in Revelation chapter 17 and verse 3. Jesus, in the celebration of the papal mass, is crucified over and over and over again. But the Bible says clearly, "Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more, death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once. But in that he liveth unto God." And again it reads, "For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself." Does Bishop Tony Palmer know what is he endorsing? Is he aware that auricular confession, pouring out your innermost sins to a fallible priest, completely robs Jesus Christ of his role as our mediator and high priestly role after the order of Melchizedek? And is he aware how blasphemous Mass is, where the priests believe that they can literally turn and transform the wafer into Jesus Christ, where Catholics sadly believe that they are eating Jesus? That is the reason why the Oxford and Cambridge educated skilled linguist and priest William Tyndale, whose statue is in the Embankment Gardens, London, got into conflict with Thomas More, whose statue is in Chelsea, London, who is a patron saint of politicians as of the year 2000, when they constantly exchanged words, where Tyndale defended the authority of the Bible and Thomas More defended the supremacy of the traditions of the Catholic Church. Tyndale says, "The Turk, when he hath sinned, runneth to the purifyings or ceremonies of Mahomet, and the Jews to the ceremonies of Moses, and the Pope unto his own ceremonies to fetch forgiveness of their sins. And the Christian goeth through repentance toward the law unto faith that is in Christ's blood." Tyndale goes deeper into Christ's current role in the plan of redemption. "For we have an advocate and intercessor, a true attorney with the Father, Jesus Christ, righteous towards God and man, and he is the reconciling and sanctification for our sins. The name of our advocate is Jesus, that is to say, a Savior. Call his name Jesus, said the angel to Joseph, he shall save his people from their sins. And this advocate and our Jesus to save us from our sins continueth ever, as it is written, and hath sempiternum sacerdotium, an everlasting office to make an atonement for sin, by the reason whereof, saith the text, he is able ever to save them that come to God through him with repentance and faith, and liveth ever to speak for us. And unto him bear all the prophets record, that all that believe in him shall receive remission of sins in his name." Acts chapter 10. "And by him only we have an entering in unto the Father and unto all grace." Ephesians 2 and 3 and Romans 5. "And yet the epistle unto the Hebrews proveth that the high priest of the old law signifieth Christ, and his offering and his going in once in the year into the inner temple signifies the offering wherewith Christ offered himself, and Christ going in unto the Father to be an everlasting or mediator for us." We are not only indebted to William Tyndale for the King James Bible, the only Bible in the English-speaking world that people can memorize text to memory, but as an ordained Catholic priest, he knew that the papal priesthood robbed Christ of his role as our high priest and redeemer, and he was one of the very few reformers who understood Christ's atoning role as our Lamb and our high priest, that is the continuation of the earthly system. "And they brought forth the goats for the sin offering before the king and the congregation, and they laid their hands upon them, and the priests killed them, and they made reconciliation with their blood upon the altar to make an atonement for all Israel. For the king commanded that the burnt offering and the sin offering should be made for all Israel." It was always the priests that made an atonement, the word that means to cleanse, to be merciful, to purge away and reconcile. And this is what Christ is doing for us right now. "Wherefore, in all things it behoved him," which means it was a must, "to be made like unto his brethren," so that we can identify with him, "that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. So Christ makes reconciliation for us as our high priest. The word reconciliation comes from the Greek word haliskemi, which means to atone for sin, to be merciful, to make reconciliation for. To tighten this study even more, let us see how Christ's atoning work was prophesied by the prophet and king David in the Psalms. Under inspiration, he wrote, "The Lord, Yahweh, with capitals, said unto my Lord Adonai," capital L with lower caps succeeding, "Sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool." Psalm 110, verse 1. What is that talking about? Well, Jesus himself explains the prophecy. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, "What think ye of Christ?" In other words, who do you think that I am? "Whose son is he?" They say unto him, "The son of David." He saith unto them, "How then does David in spirit call him Lord, saying, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou at my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool? If David then call him Lord, how is he a son?" So Christ clearly shows that the Lord with the capital N and lowercase applies unto himself who sits at the right hand of the Father. But the psalmist David continues, "The Lord hath sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." The book of Hebrews clearly explains that this is Christ. Whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 20. So when we sin against God, we go to no earthly priest but Jesus. If we confess our sins, he, Christ, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate, as William Tyndale said, with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. So Christ is our advocate. What does an advocate actually do? According to Virtue's English Dictionary, the word advocate means one who pleads the cause of another in a court of law, one who defends, vindicates, or espouses a cause by argument. That's what Christ does for us, and no earthly, mortal, fallible priest has any right taking that responsibility. For a misinterpretation of scripture can destroy a whole belief system. Listen to this passage. "And when he had said this, he breathed on them and saith unto them, Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained." The Catholic priesthood misquote this text and apply it to auricular confession. But Peter, one of the disciples who this command was given to, explains it clearly. "To him," talking about Christ, "give all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins." Not confessing to a priest. Tony Palmer tries to cleverly distort history by declaring that the Augustinian monk Martin Luther started the Protestant Reformation.
Why are we opposed?
Because Luther's protest has been, it's almost 500 years since Luther began the protest when he wrote his 95 Theses. Mm. 1999, the 31st of October in Augsburg, the Catholic Church and the Lutheran Federation worldwide signed a document accepting and redefining the definition of justification, stating that we are saved by grace through faith alone and not by works. But we are saved to good works, mm-hmm. not by good works. And that brought an end to the protest, because that was Luther's main point of the protest. So since 1999, the protest has been signed, and we're now living in a post-Protestant era.
Does that mean...
Was Martin Luther solely responsible for the movement that severed half of the Western European continent from papal rule? Jean-Henri Merle d'Aubigné was a descendant of French Protestant refugees. He was born in Geneva and a solid historian who received an honorary Oxford doctorate, who preached before Queen Victoria. He wrote a book on the history of the Reformation and shares something that Tony Palmer deletes. God, who prepared his own work, raised up in every period of every age a long list of witnesses to the truth. Scarcely had Rome usurped the sovereign power when a fierce opposition was forced against her authority, which lasted throughout the course of the Middle Ages. The Archbishop Claudius of Turin in the 9th century, Peter of Bruges, his pupil Henry, Arnold of Brescia in the 12th century, in France and in Italy, strove to re-establish the worship of God in spirit and in truth. Peter Vaud or Voldo, a rich merchant in Lyons, disposed of all his wealth and gave it to the poor. He appeared, as well as his friends, to have experienced a desire to establish in his lifetime the perfection of primitive Christianity. He began thus, as it were, to cultivate the branches and not the roots of the tree. Nevertheless, his witness is powerful, because he appeals therein to the scriptures, and they shake the Roman hierarchy at the mainstone of its foundations. Wycliffe appeared in England in 1360, and there made an appeal from the Pope to the Word of God. The doctrines of Wycliffe, issuing from the College of Oxford, had spread rapidly over the whole extent of Christendom, and had secured adherents in Bavaria, Swabia, Franconia, and Prussia. John Huss raised his voice in Bohemia 100 years before Luther offered to speak in Saxony. He appeared to have dipped deeper than his predecessors into the real essence of Christian faith. The Dominican Jerome Savonarola, soon after his entrance into the Order of Bologna in 1475, delivered himself over to the constant practices of prayer, fastings, and mortification, and was wont to cry out, "O thou art good, in thy kindness teach me thy justice." The reformer Zwinglius was brought from the hut of a shepherd of the Alps. Melanchthon, the theologian of the Reformation, from the shop of a gunsmith, and Luther from the cottage of a poor farmer. It is an error to believe that Christianity had no existence up to the time of the Reformation, save under the forms of the Roman Catholic religion, and that thus the division of the church had merely put on the garb of Protestant forms and ceremonies. The very essence of Protestantism practically say we must obey God rather than man. 4 centuries before Martin Luther, Arnold of Brescia was preaching reform in his native Italy, teaching a simplicity of lifestyle, and he condemned the vast wealth of the papacy and its endless bloody wars. He was later burned alive. Peter Waldo, an extremely wealthy merchant, saw a colleague die suddenly. It shook him to the core, and he converted to Christ and used all his wealth to help the poor and to produce Bibles, and he preached reform and simplicity. 2 centuries later, the Oxford teacher styled the morning star of the Reformation, the evangelical doctor John Wycliffe, used all of his energies and intellect not to be famous and popular and to gain notoriety like preachers of today, but to evangelize the British Isles in the simplicity of the scriptures. Today we have smartphones, and in less than a minute we can download the whole Bible. In Wycliffe's day, there was no digital media, neither a printing press, so they had to use their pen to paper, which drove Wycliffe and his young disciples even more zealous to share the word, a zeal that has not been since seen. Jerome studied in the University of Oxford, and he shared Wycliffe's writings in his native Czechoslovakia to the Czech reformer John Huss, a man who was strongly influenced by Wycliffe in the 1400s, a century after Wycliffe's death. Both Jerome and John Huss were martyred for sharing with the common man the word of God. The authorities in the Czech country had all of Wycliffe's writings burnt, so there would be no trace of the Reformation. But when people hunger for truth, you can't stop them. And soldiers would hunt people down like they were animals to kill them. And people had to hide deep within caves just so that they can read the Bible and not be subject to the authority of the Pope. This is how hungry people are for the Word of God. Though Wycliffe planted the seed, what enabled the Reformation to spread even more rapidly were two men, and only one seems to be recognized by historians. Laurens Janszoon Koster, a Dutch printer who has been strongly deleted from the history books, and Johannes Gutenberg, the German engraver and inventor who has gotten the sole credit for the invention of the printing press. The narrator, while studying media at university, was taught that it was the printing press and the Reformation that catapulted and gave us today the modern media, a means whereby one can express him or herself without the authorities controlling you or marginalizing you for having independent thought. In London's Victorian Albert Museum, there is on display a copy of Martin Luther's Bible, as well as a copy of the works of Philip Melanchthon. The last reformer before Luther was the Dominican friar Savonarola. During the Renaissance, which means rebirth, which is nothing more than a revival of Greek paganism, he also preached reform, and along with two other friars, he was hanged and burnt on May the 23rd, 1498. This was 19 years and 2 months before Martin Luther nailed his 95 Theses. And we see that 4 centuries before Luther, the Protestant Reformation was already underway. And when bogus historians, both secular and religious, say that the Reformation started in the 16th century, they are deliberately deleting history. This was a quick study to show you that you need to know history, you need to study, to show and be alert of what is going on in world affairs, and not to be afraid of being called a conspiracy theorist. And everything the narrator says, please test them according to the Bible and according to history. You cannot depend on no preacher or church. You can only fully depend upon the Word of God. For if your foundation is in the rock, which is Jesus Christ, nothing can shake you.